And the other thing is, like, smokers get bladder cancer.
Yes, yes.
And that, you know, I think, first of all, people that smoke should quit smoking, first and foremost. But if they don't quit smoking, I mean, I think they should be consuming broccoli sprouts like nobody's business, you know. Because, I mean, they're accumulating so much benzene and all sorts of carcinogens, so.
I used to know a seedsman, a guy who ran a seed company, and he smoked like a chimney, smoked cigarettes. And when he learned about the broccoli sprout story, he would eat a handful of broccolis, toast a handful of broccoli seeds and eat them. And he claimed he was doing that to counterbalance his cigarettes. I couldn't advise him on that.
Right.
Well, you mentioned benzene a number of times, and we didn't talk about the China studies, but with our colleague Tom Kensler and a whole many others, we did a series of studies over the years, starting in about 2002. Interestingly, it started out in an area of China, subsistence farming area just north of Shanghai, where there was a lot of aflatoxin exposure. And so we were looking at liver cancer risk, looking at biomarkers of liver cancer and excretion of aflatoxin adducts vis-a-vis intake of sulforaphane. Over time, as those studies progressed, there was a series of studies, the liver cancer risk started to come down because they were exporting their contaminated grain to other parts of China from this region. And with globalization, they were importing more and more food, so their diet was becoming less aflatoxin rich. But at the same time, of course, air pollution was going through the roof. And so the most recent of those studies we published in 2014 showed really a dramatic enhancement of the clearance of benzene and acrolein, another pollutant conjugates, in lockstep with broccoli sprout extract consumption.
It was a 60% increase in excretion, which is just phenomenal. And it convinced me, like, you know, it definitely is a problem in China, but, you know,
India.
I mean, but we've got air pollution here in the U.S., and I live next to a busy street, and, you know, I see all sorts of things accumulating in my place that, you know, I'm taking that for my benzene excretion as well. So it's very powerful, and it was just within 24 hours.
It's a dramatic effect, and so that's an interesting public health dilemma.
Yeah.
There, you can tell someone not to smoke. You can put sort of say in the back of your mind. I would never say this out loud, but in the back of your mind, you can say they had it coming. The idiots wouldn't stop smoking. We'd never say things like that. It's not politically correct, but with air pollution, people are trapped. Whether it's highly educated people like you that are living on the street where you know there's pollution, or people in the developing world where, you know,
you have to breathe.
You've got to breathe.
You have to breathe.
And air pollution is, and breathe and sleep, and we can go on.
Yeah, it's becoming, it's an increasing problem, and I've seen just more and more studies. You know, a lot of people have focused on the you know, effects on respiratory inflammation and those sorts of, which are very obvious, but like I said, the other health disease risk that's really becoming evident with air pollution is actually heart attacks and stroke, because it's causing low-level chronic inflammation, you know, and that's, of course, where sulforaphane shines, you know, I mean, it's inhibiting NF-kappa B pathway, like you said, activating, you know, all these anti-inflammatory pathways, so... Yeah. It seems like a no-brainer. It'd be nice to get something like that into China and India, broccoli sprout. Well, I guess India, they've got moringa, so.
True. So if I were doing a similar sister study to the broccoli sprout air pollution study in India, I would want to do it with moringa,
right.
I think.